people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect. The
yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about the breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Pakistan kills 3 Kashmiri civilians in cross-border shelling. Aslam Farooqi's arrest brought ISKP's Pak connections into focus, says a Europe-based think tank. Government and terrorist nexus exposed as terror entities continue to operate openly and freely in Pakistan. And Pak-based terror groups exploiting COVID-19 to recruit jihadis. Viewers, beginning with bursting Pakistan's nefarious agendas in Kashmir, this report will show you how Pakistan is resorting to incessant ceasefire violation at LOC to push infiltrators into Kashmir, even in the days of coronavirus pandemic, which has already disrupted the entire system of livelihood in South Asia and across the world. Political activists from POK also suggest Pakistan Army's firing at the LOC is a technique being used by Islamabad to distract the world from its failure in combating COVID-19 in the regions under its forceful occupation, a report.
Frustrated by repeated failures at fomenting terror in Kashmir, the Pakistan Army has intensified the range and frequency of cross-border firing at the line of control. While Indian security forces are successfully eliminating major Pakistan-based terrorists who infiltrate into Indian territories under the guise of cross-border shelling, Pakistan is busy targeting innocent civilians living at the border to avenge its defeat. 3 persons, including a woman and child, were killed in artillery shelling by Pakistan in Kupwara district near the line of control in North Kashmir this week. The Pakistani shells landed in several villages near the border, including Hajithara, Dhani, Chokibal and Timuna Vilgam. According to reports, 2 houses and several vehicles were also damaged in the cross-border shelling of Pakistan Army.
हमारा मकान जल के हाक हो गया, एक गाड़ी, 2-4 बाइक बिल्कुल ख़त्म हो गए मकान ही में, तो पेड़ जितने थे सेब के वो भी खत्म हो
गए,
और एक चाचा का लड़का वो भी जगह पर उधर ही ख़त्म हो गई, जगह पर डेथ हो गई उसकी।
जख्मी कितनी हुए?
जख्मी हो गए 3।
और कोई औरत उनमें?
एक औरत है, एक मर्द है।
The Pakistan offensive in Kupwara comes after the Indian Army targeted terror launch pads and Pakistan Army installation aiding infiltration last week in the same sector. Locals living near borders are terrified because of continuous shelling by Pakistan. They say the firings have made their lives difficult, especially amid the ongoing pandemic.
ये एक नौजवान आदमी बेचारा अपने गाड़ी में के पास था और पाकिस्तानी शैल जब आकर गिरा और ये जख्मी हो गया। हमने वहाँ से SP साहब और DC साहब से बात की, उन्होंने फौरी तौर वहाँ पर गाड़ी एम्बुलेंस वहाँ भेजी और इस वक्त जेरे इलाज है इस वक्त अस्पताल में।
The lockdown due to the COVID-19 outbreak has not deterred terrorists from Pakistan from making infiltration attempts. The skirmishes along the LOC have been taking place since the beginning of the year, despite the coronavirus scare. In January, the number was at 367, February 366, and as the pandemic hit India and Pakistan in March, the number swelled to 411. The latest tally stands at 53.
फायरिंग चल रही है पाकिस्तान की तरफ से, रुक रुक के अभी भी शेलिंग हो रही है और कल शाम को भी फायरिंग हुआ था, और इस तरफ से लोग बहुत डरे हुए हैं, घबराए हुए हैं। दूसरी तरफ कोरोना का होप है और इस तरफ पाकिस्तान भी नापाक रकों से दोबारा फायरिंग कर रहा है और हिंदुस्तान उसका मुंह तोड़ जवाब दे रहा है।
अमजद अयूब मिर्जा, अ पॉलिटिकल एक्टिविस्ट फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान ऑक्यूपाइड कश्मीर, सेज दैट पाकिस्तान शुड बी रिप्लाइड विद अग्रेसिव काउंटर टेररिज्म मेजर्स इन जम्मू एंड कश्मीर to foil its infiltration attempts amid the coronavirus outbreak, affirming that ceasefire violation is always initiated from Pakistan's side. Mirza reveals that Pakistan is also responsible for casualties in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir since the firings are launched by Pakistani troops who take shelter in civilian areas.
Ceasefire line par is waqt jo golabari ho rahi hai, iski tamam tar जिम्मेदारी पाकिस्तान पर आयद होती है, क्योंकि सीज फायर लाइन हमें पता है, हम पीओजेके के लोगों को भी पता है कि सीज फायर लाइन पर हमेशा पाकिस्तान ने गोलाबारी में पहल की है। इंडिया रिटेलिएटरी फायर करता है। अब होता यह है कि पाकिस्तान की आर्मी ने पाकिस्तानी मकबूजा कश्मीर यानी पीओजेके में अपनी गने मस्जिदों में और गांव के बीच में लगाई हुई है, लिहाजा जब रिटेलिएटरी फायर आता है तो उससे पीओजेके में सिविल कैजुअल्टीज भी होती हैं, और उन सिविल कैजुअल्टीज को फिर पाकिस्तान अपने मीडिया के जरिए और इंटरनेशनल मीडिया के जरिए हाईलाइट करता है और कहता है कि ये इंडिया की तरफ से की गई एट्रोसिटीज है।
अयूब रिवील्स दैट पाकिस्तान इज रिजॉर्टिंग टू सीज़फ़ायर वायलेशन टू डिस्ट्रैक्ट ग्लोबल अटेंशन from its inefficiency and lack of interest in dealing with COVID-19 pandemic in the regions under its forceful occupation.
इस वक्त जो सीज़फ़ायर लाइन की वायलेशन है, ये भी पाकिस्तान ने शुरू की है, और इतने दूर तक उन्होंने जम्मू के अंदर गोले फेंके हैं कि वो इलाके सीज़फ़ायर लाइन की ज्यूरिसडिक्शन में आते ही नहीं, उससे बहुत बाहर है। तो पाकिस्तान ऐसा क्यों कर रहा है? पाकिस्तान ऐसा करने की तीन ही वजूहात समझ में आ सकती हैं। पहली वजह ये कि चूंकि कोरोना वायरस की वजह से वो बेनकाब हो गए हैं और वो इसको कंट्रोल नहीं कर पा रहे, उनके पास हॉस्पिटल्स नहीं है, क्वारंटाइन सिस्टम नहीं है, वेंटिलेटर्स नहीं है, और ख़ास तौर पर पीओजेके की हालत इस वक्त बहुत बुरी है। वहाँ ना खाने पीने की अशिया मिल रही हैं, अस्पतालों में डॉक्टर नहीं है, अगर कोई डॉक्टर है तो उसके पास ट्रीटमेंट की टेस्ट किट नहीं है, इक्विपमेंट नहीं है। तो एक तो इस जो ये इमर्जिंग क्राइसिस है जो आगे जाके बहुत बड़ा एक स्टेट को चैलेंज कर सकता है, इससे लोगों की तवज्जो हटाने के लिए यह सीज फायर लाइन पर गोलाबारी पाकिस्तान ने शुरू की।
अ सीज फायर वायलेशन एक्ट्स लाइक अ कवर फायर फॉर इन्फिल्ट्रेशन फ्रॉम अक्रॉस द बॉर्डर, and Pakistan is using this tactic to spread coronavirus infection into Jammu and Kashmir, says the activist.
Dusri iski wajah ye hai ki ceasefire line par jab bhi Pakistan golabari karta hai to uska matlab ye hota hai ki inhone ab yahan se Pakistan se jo infiltrator hai jihadi terrorist jo hai inko border par karana hota hai, to ye us golabari ke जो है अंडरकवर ये उनको बॉर्डर क्रॉस कराते हैं। अब इन्होंने ये फैसला किया है कि कोरोना के जो पेशेंट्स हैं जहादी उनको बॉर्डर क्रॉस कराएं, ताकि ये जम्मू से होते हुए और कश्मीर में जाके जो है ये वहां पे कोरोना वायरस की वबा को फैलाएं।
पाकिस्तान हैज बीन इंक्रीजिंगली वायलेटिंग द सीज़फ़ायर अग्रीमेंट विद इंडिया इवन एज द फोकस इन द टू कंट्रीज हैज शिफ्टेड to fight the coronavirus pandemic. All through the week, it fired small arms and mortar shells along the LOC in Poonch district. India's Minister of State for Defense, Shripad Nayak, had last month informed the parliament that Pakistan violated the ceasefire at least 646 times between January 1st and February 23 this year.
Arrest of Aslam Faruqi, the perpetrator of Kabul Gurdwara attack, and the leading investigation has brought into clues that linked the deadly attack with Pakistan and its sponsored terrorist groups. A Europe-based think tank released an article recently after the Kabul Gurdwara attack, deliberating on terrorist relations between the ISI and Islamic State of Khorasan province. In the same write-up, it also focuses upon ISI's attempts of escalating insurgency in Afghanistan. A report. The arrest of Abdullah Orakzai, alias Aslam Faruqi, a key leader of the Islamic State in Khorasan province, or ISKP, has brought the terror group's Pakistani connections into sharp focus, opines a European think tank. In an article titled Pakistan's Role in Kabul Gurdwara Attack Has Been Established and Its Mounting Despondency Is Becoming Starkly Evident, the European Foundation for South Asian Studies, or EFSA, says that the recent arrest by Afghan security forces related to the terror attack on a Gurdwara in Kabul last month have confirmed its assessment of the involvement of Pakistan's inter-services intelligence. It had been postulated that the choice of target, the historical fact of Pakistan being behind all major terror attacks over the years against Indian interests in Afghanistan, and the claim by the perpetrators that the attack was aimed at avenging Indian actions in Kashmir, all left little doubt that it was the Pakistani Inter-Services Intelligence, or ISI, that had orchestrated the attack and had used its terrorist proxies, the Haqqani Network and the Lashkar-e-Toyba, to do the dirty work on its behalf, the EFSA said in its commentary. According to EFSA's statement by National Directorate of Security of the Afghan Intelligence Service, discloses Faruqi's close relations with Pakistan-based and backed terrorist groups such as the Haqqani Network and the Lashkar-e-Toyba. The NDA statement also reveals Faruqi's link with the regional intelligence agencies, which the think tank termed as euphemism for the ISI.
The kind of groups Pakistan has always supported, these are people for whom people of other faiths apart from their own faith are what are called can be killed. So the term that they use is wajibul qatl. And this is not surprising if you look at the kind of activities Pakistani backed groups have undertaken, the ruthlessness, the cruelty with which they have gone after minorities in various countries. This should not surprise anybody at all.
The EFSA's in its research paper also talks about reports indicating that some of the ISI's Kashmir-centric terrorist set have begun bolstering their presence in Afghanistan. The LET, which had initially been formed in Kunar province of Afghanistan, has continued to maintain a presence there, suggesting that it is now in expansion mode in Kunar as well as the adjacent Nangarhar province. The Jaish-e-Mohammed, or JEM, meanwhile, has reportedly recently appointed commanders for as many as 12 Afghan provinces, including Kunar, Nangarhar, Paktia, Parwan, Hunduz, Ghazni, Nimroz, Helmand, Kandahar, and Urzagan.
People who basically got tired or get left out of the Afghan jihad were sent to Kashmir and so on and so forth. And now, since Kashmir has become hot, and you have an agreement with the Afghan government whereby the Taliban is, at least on paper, at least on the looks of it, on the verge of making a comeback. So Kashmir being far more hot for these terrorists than Afghanistan, people are trying to make an entry into Afghanistan. These are pawn pieces in a chess game which Pakistan uses interchangeably, sometimes on the Kashmir chessboard and sometimes on the Pakistan chessboard. So this is not surprising at all. These are, after all, pawns, and wherever Pakistan can create terror with minimum effort and minimum damage to itself and the maximum effort it can get for its terrorist activities, these people will go there.
Recently, a big group of Jaish-e-Mohammed cadre was intercepted by Afghan security forces on the night of April 13th and 14th. While trying to cross over into Nangarhar province of Afghanistan in the Mohammadara area along the elements of the Taliban. Several JEM cadre were killed and large consignment of arms and ammunitions as well as parts of a bomb were recovered. This included two mortar launchers, one RGB and three Russian sniper rifles. One of the Jaish cadre was captured alive and confirmed that he had been sent from Pakistan.
कौन से रास्ते से आए आप
बाढ़ वाले से
कौन सी जोर से बोलो
बाढ़ बाढ़
बाढ़ के रास्ते से अच्छा इधर तुसी मिखारदार है ना इत्थू इधर कहां पे रास्ता है क्या पाकिस्तान से इधर आई थी
इसमें हम रात को ऐसे बाहर आ जाते हैं
कितने दिन आपको इधर जो तबलीग था कितने दिन था यहाँ पर
तबलीग में चार महीने लगाए थे इधर आए हुए दस दिन
इधर आए हुए दस दिन
The presence of these terrorists along the Afghan-Pakistan border proves ISI's relocation plan, which involves relocating Pakistani terrorists to Afghanistan, where a large number of terrorists are already present, making it easier for ISI's assets to slip under the radar. Relocating these terrorists not only caters to Pakistan's mischievous interests in Afghanistan, but also serves its purpose of keeping its territory clean when audited by global counter-terrorism agencies. Pakistan's tall claims of having launched a crackdown against various terror entities and terror funding sources in the country have fallen flat, as a number of evidences show that the terror organizations in the country are still operating in full swing. Disguised as humanitarian missions, the terror fronts in Pakistan are carrying out their activities under the patronage of Pakistani government and the Inter-Services Intelligence or ISI, a report.
Pakistan government's claims of having launched a crackdown against Jamaat-ud-Dawah and Falah-e-Insaniyat Foundation and seizure of all their offices were exposed as numerous videos surfaced showing the still functional workplaces of these so-called charities. Videos show that the offices of occupied region of Muzaffarabad, which has been used as a launch pad by terrorists for years, still has the entire infrastructure available to operate from the region. These organizations were either operating under a different banner or no banner for meantime to avoid the limelight.
चंद दिन पहले हुकूमत ने जमात-उद-दावा और फलाह-ए-इंसानियत के खिलाफ जो इकदाम किए उसमें हमारे जो जारी मनसूबाजात थे जिनमें हमारे मराकज हैं मदारस हैं वहाँ पर उन्होंने आके एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर बिठाए हैं और हमें कोई बात नहीं बताई जा रही कि वो कहते हैं जी हमारे बोर्ड हटा दिए उन्होंने और अपने महकमा औकाफ़ के बोर्ड लगा दिए हैं उनके लोग बिठा दिए इंतज़ामिया के लोग वहाँ पर बैठे हैं तो वो कहते हैं जी जमात-उद-दावा चूँकि यूनाइटेड नेशन ने बैन किया है लिहाजा हम भी इस बात के पाबंद हैं कि हम आपको बैन करें और आपके जो जितने जारी मनसूबाजात हैं मसलन कश्मीर में काम कर रहे हैं थरपारकर में काम कर रहे हैं ठीक है ना जी या आसाम में काम करते हैं अब आपको पता ही होगा पीछे जब साने अहमदपुर हुआ तो सबसे ज़्यादा काम फलाह-ए-इंसानियत फाउंडेशन ने किया हमारा काम तो लोगों की खिदमत करना है लोगों की मदद करना है ठीक है ना जी लोगों को डूबते लोगों को बचाना है
Video evidence show that these offices were not just running in the occupied region but also in Pakistani cities of Bahawalpur, Rawalpindi, Lahore, Sheikhupura, Multan, Peshawar, Hyderabad and Sukkur. Both these terrorist fronts, disguised as humanitarian organizations, are operating under the direct patronage of Pakistani government and inter-service intelligence are headed by Hafiz Saeed, the founder of Lashkar-e-Taiba, a designated terrorist by UN and the United States of America.
जहाँ सब लोग आ जाते हैं वहाँ फ्लाइंसन के लोग अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह जाकर काम करते हैं मेहनत कर रहे हैं हुकूमत पता नहीं किसके प्रेशर में आके ये काम करना चाहती है और जमात के साथ हज़ारों लोग वाबस्ता हैं उनके चूल्हे ठंडे होने का खदशा है फिर हमें ये कहा गया कि आप प्रॉम नहीं कर सकते आप फंड कलेक्शन नहीं कर सकते अगर हम ये काम नहीं करेंगे तो नतीजा ये निकलेगा कि लोग भूखे मर जाएंगे लोग तो पहले बेचारे जो है ना वो मर रहे हैं
Pakistan, in order to avoid being named in the watch list of Financial Action Task Force, had scripted a plan of banning these organizations, asking them to reduce their activities on ground and hand over ambulances to government authorities and remove name boards from its premises. However, Pakistan faced a huge embarrassment after the global money laundering watchdog put Islamabad back on its terrorist financing watch list this year. It comes as a major setback to Islamabad, as the move could seriously hurt Pakistan's economy by making it a pariah state in the global financial systems.
As the whole world is focused on fighting the COVID-19 pandemic together, Pakistan-based terror groups are taking the advantage of this crisis, including the economic disruptions, to unleash violence and recruit more terrorists. Recently, Western anti-terror observers indicated towards the disturbing signs of increased terror activities in Pakistan, while the world remains focused on fighting the pandemic, a report.
Western anti-terror observers are seeing disturbing signs of terror groups like the Pakistan-based Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed and others like the Hizbul Mujahideen exploiting the COVID-19 turmoil, including the economic disruptions, to ramp up their recruitment of jihadi foot soldiers. According to Dr. Siegfried Wolf, Director of Research at the South Asia Democratic Front, a Brussels-based think tank, jihadi groups have a long tradition of exploiting crisis situations for their terrorist activities, recruitment and propaganda campaign in South Asia, especially in the Afghanistan-Pakistan region. Thousands of youth lose their livelihood in the economic turmoil brought about by the coronavirus and are easy prey for terrorist organizations like the LET, Jaish-e-Mohammed and Hizbul Mujahideen. He further said that the states and their societies are in particular vulnerable situation in all aspects of daily life, as they are already facing an extraordinary challenge of coronavirus. Thus, terrorists are trying to exploit these conditions to produce maximum fear and to further escalate the crisis with their violent and verbal assaults. Dr. Wolf told that jihadists in Pakistan also use the crisis to undermine the government, for example, by ignoring lockdown and social distance regulations. The fact that Pakistan's administration shows once again its total incompetence to handle a civilian crisis situation and brings out the most unfortunate features of the country's political culture and patterns helps the religious fanatics to step up their efforts in spreading jihadist propaganda. Pakistan is home to various Islamic jihadi outfits like Lashkar-e-Taiba, Haqqani Network, the Taliban and Jaish-e-Mohammed. Experts have warned that these terrorist groups are using infodemic to spread their nefarious agenda. Taha Siddiqui, a Pakistani journalist in exile living in France, said, "During this pandemic, there is also an infodemic. Far-right-wing groups and Islamist extremists are joining the infodemic bandwagon to achieve their evil and nefarious agendas. Since the outbreak of coronavirus, people globally are feeling insecure and looking for answers or a way out, and such groups exploit these insecurities to radicalize the naive population." Siddiqui also said that at one side, far-right groups are spreading conspiracies about how the virus has been unleashed on purpose. Islamists, on the other, are calling this a divine punishment and urging Muslims to come back to the so-called righteous path, which usually entails violent behavior. Experts suggest that security agencies and social media networks need to work together to expose and stop such groups. Junaid Qureshi, the director of Amsterdam-based European Foundation for South Asian Studies, said, "It is of course horrific to learn that while the world is fighting against the COVID-19 pandemic, terrorist groups are trying to exploit this turmoil and turbulent times by advancing their agenda and recruitment policies. However, it is not surprising, as terrorist groups have an embedded character of exploitation in their modus operandi. They exist because they exploit religion, uneducated people, poor people, political instabilities in regions, caste, color, and in this case, a global pandemic. The tactic of terrorist groups is exploitation followed by subsequent weaponizing their so-called success of exploitation. The same is happening now, as some may exploit and weaponize the pandemic while others will exploit by weaponizing those who have been tested positive or otherwise been a victim of the pandemic, whether economically, politically or socially. He believes counter-terrorism discourse and operations in this new environment are equally important as the healthcare and economic impact of COVID-19. Qureshi said that we cannot and must not expect mortality in these hard times from terrorists and terrorist organizations, and as such, we must ensure that these elements do not get emboldened by the fact that our attention might drop as we fight the coronavirus. Junaid further said that the world will find a medical solution to COVID-19 in the course of time. Terrorism will still be there, and the only solution is to continue keeping a hawk's eye focus on the changing dynamics of terrorist organizations and its supporters and keep adapting in order to counter it.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Surbhi Sharma signing off on the behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.